Already, I'm presenting to you today the Virtual Brain Simulation Platform. What is behind this? First of all, it's a software, it's open source. You can go to the website and download it. It went open source or publicly in 2012. And since then we had, so I did that actually last week, the screenshot, more than 21,000 downloads. Maybe it's now even 22,000 by today. So we have several publications already occurring using the Virtual Brain software. And you might note it went public 1 year before the Human Brain Project actually started. So this independent was independently initiated from the Human Brain Project. Now we have a sub-project or so-called co-design project also in the Human Brain Project where the Virtual Brain is a central part. So what does the Virtual Brain platform do? It brings together computational neuroscience with multimodal brain imaging. So basically by linking up these two components, it is possible to construct personalized brain models. As Paul just mentioned, you can basically create a patient brain on the computer and use it to make predictions for a patient. And this is my colleague Jessica. And I show you now with her brain how we construct such a brain network model. This is she again, without hair. So we reconstruct from magnetic resonance imaging data the surfaces of the skull, the cortex, we reconstruct the nerve fibers, and then we can use different parcellation schemes using different modalities or anatomical landmarks to parcellate the brain in different regions, and each region then is represented by a population model, and they are interacting through this individual anatomical skeleton. So now each of the populations representing a region is generating activity. So we can simulate population spikes. Sorry, I have a bad cough, so I hope I'm not annoying you too much with this. So we can simulate population spikes, mean field potentials or local field potentials, and then we have forward solutions to simulate EEG, MEG, and fMRI bulk signal. So this is what the platform does. In order to personalize these models, you can use your own subjects' data. These can be patients or healthy subjects, and for this you have to process the imaging data. And we created a pipeline for this that is also open source and publicly available. It is already pre-installed on some supercomputers ready for use. So one installation is in the US at the Neuroscience Gateway cluster. And every neuroscientist can use it, and also the computing resources behind. Another installation is on the collaboratory of the Human Brain Project, where also every scientist can register and use these resources. So this is the pipeline, and it generates the connectomes that you use then to constrain your brain network models. So now, since we are simulating full brains, you might be clear about that we are not simulating individual neurons. This would be impossible. We take advantage of this fundamental principle in nature, synchronization. This is a murmuration of starlings. This is not as nice, but it's in Berlin. These are crows. The principle is the same. There's synchronization between the autonomous elements of this swarm, of this flock of birds. Here we see neurons in the phase space. The phase space is spent by the membrane potential and the opening probability of the ion channels, and you see that these neurons are also synchronizing. And here what you don't see is there's a little red cross. This is a mean field approximation of this neuronal population that we use in the virtual brain in order to describe the population dynamics. So it's a reduced description of what really happens in the brain. So we are not typically, I'll show you an exception in a moment, simulate individual neuron networks. We summarize the activity of large populations of neurons with so-called mean field or neural mass models. And in the virtual brain software, you have a full repertoire choice selection of these neural mass models, from very simple phenomenological mathematical models like oscillators to more biologically grounded and complex population models. And I will show you a few examples during my presentation. Here's one. This is a reduced Wang Wang model, where we have a mean field description of the excitatory populations and the inhibitory population. And as you can see, there's some connectivity neuromodulation that averages across this entire population. So we have NMDA coupling, excitatory coupling, and inhibitory GABAergic coupling within a population. So this thing sits in each of these nodes and generates differential equations, or the differential equation generates the state variables, and they are interacting and influencing each other through this connectome. And this is the mathematics, the general evolution equation behind this. It's not very well visible. Anyway, so this is a differential operator. This N stands for the selected population model. So in the case of the software TVB, you can choose between about 15 different. X is a vector of state variables, so N is a state operator. And this can be the mean field potentials, so the firing rates, and so forth. And here you see the first sum operator. In this term, we sum up the activity of all connected populations of population I. And the activity is weighted by the structural connectivity matrix that contains the connection strengths inferred from diffusion tensor imaging data between the individual region pairs ij. And the activity of the connected regions j is summed up after a time delay d, which is contained in this matrix D, and is computed based on the distances between the region pairs. So from the individual connectome, we infer the distances between the regions and the connection strengths between the regions. And this is what TVB uses to constrain their models and make them individual. So then this is another sum operator for local connectivities. This is something that I will not cover today, but you can also do much more detailed simulations where you take into account the surface geometry of an individual cortex. And this is the kernel that has been used, the local connectivity kernel that is getting rescaled by a factor. Also the structural connectivity, the large scale structural connectivity is rescaled by the factor G, because it contains no absolute values, but only relative weights, and they have to be rescaled with a parameter. Same for the local connectivity. This is important again. This is an input current that can be injected and can mimic stimulation. So you can stimulate certain brain regions and you can add up noise. So here you see now the components that are individual. It's a structural connectivity weights that come from the diffusion tensor imaging data. It's the distances between the region pairs. I mentioned that already. And if you do surface simulation, it's also the local connectivity kernel that takes into account the surface of the individual. And I think that's it. So now I mentioned just a few minutes ago that we do simulations based on population models. But we noticed soon that with this, we, for many cases, oversimplify the situation because the brain is complex for a purpose. And in order to investigate certain phenomena we are interested in, for example, learning and memory, we need a little bit more detail. But nevertheless, it's impossible, as we all know, to simulate the 100 billions of the neurons of the brain. So the solution that we develop now, and several other groups actually, I think also here in Barcelona, are multi-scale simulations. So what does it mean? It means that the majority of the regions are still represented by population models, but those regions that are relevant for certain, for example, disease or cognitive scenario we are interested in, are simulated with more detail. In this case, the hippocampus, entorhinal cortex, and dopaminergic midbrain. And then the connectivity that we use here at the microscopic scale is much more detailed, and we don't get it from the diffusion tensor imaging data, but we in this case got it from the literature, and it was painful, so it would be really nice, and this is actually a hope for the human brain project, if all this knowledge could be somehow collected and easily accessible in a platform. So now, and actually there's work on digitalizing atlases and connecting them in the future to the virtual brain, but in the moment it is not yet possible. So what we can do now with such a model is to investigate, for example, how changes in the large-scale connectome, like a neurodegeneration decrease of myelinization, would interact with the capability of a microscopically detailed network to express certain features. For example, here we implemented spike time independent plasticity. And vice versa, if we modulate the microscopic network, for example, if we change the density of the neurons in the microscopically detailed network to mimic also neurodegeneration, we can see whether this changes the large scale behavior. So this has been now developed as a first proof of concept, as a co-simulation between the virtual brain and Nest software. Nest software is a very well established and advanced software for microscopically detailed or cellular level neuronal simulations. The nice thing about Nest software is that it is parallelizable. It is capable from multi-threading. It runs on high-performance computers, easily test message passing interfaces, so you can also run it very efficiently on supercomputers. So what do we do here? We basically, for each time step, simulate the population activity and the microscopically detailed network activity, and then integrate, and then comes the next time step. So in the moment, it is not very computationally efficient, and the goal is to make it computationally more efficient in the future. But it is also available for testing purposes in the collaboratory. It's public, so you can look for this collaboratory, and we have example Jupyter notebooks and also a didactic video how to use this cool simulation environment. Now I go back to the more classic TVB. This is a simulation of 20 minutes of resting state activity of actually also with Jessica, that who I showed in the beginning. And we use the reduced Wang Wang model that is described by these equations developed by Victor Gil, by Gustavo Deco. So these are the input currents that drive the excitatory and inhibitory population. Activity is translated in R firing rates of the excitatory and inhibitory population and synaptic activity of the excitatory and inhibitory population. And what you see here is for one picked region, the firing rates of the excitatory and the inhibitory population. So while we are reproducing the large-scale activity that we can measure in Jessica's brain, we at the same time construct with the software, with the virtual brain, a model how at the local level and the global level the neuronal populations do interact, and can generate, for example, the firing rates of these regions, the excitatory and inhibitory firing rates that we couldn't measure non-invasively in an individual. And this is actually the nice thing, that the virtual brain gives us a method to think about complex theories of brain function make predictions that then can be tested again experimentally. So if you imagine you would have to think about the brain just with the power of your mind and make all these predictions, that's impossible. Also, if you write it down or try to formulate it semantically, it's impossible because it's too complex. But the virtual brain offers us now a tool to really make up new theories and generate predictions that then can be tested again. And here this is a publication, and it's a little bit lengthy if I would go through the entire publication, but if you're interested, you can read it. It was published last year in eLife. I want to make one point here with this simulation that I showed you on the previous slide, which looked pretty simple. Even though it looks simple, it captures many different features that we know from empirical data and brings them together in one basically self-consistent framework. So this is a time scale. The upper panel is the features in our simulated data. The lower panel is the features in our, not in our, in experimental data that have been published before and that come even from different species because some of the recordings are only possible invasively. So what the model reproduces goes from the relation of firing rates to the phase of the membrane potential up to the switching dynamics of the functional connectivity that you measure with non-invasive neuroimaging. So here, this is the firing rate and the phase. So this is an alpha cycle of the membrane potential. This has been measured in monkeys, and there is a certain phase firing rate relationship that is reproduced and captured by the model. Here you see the ratio of inhibitor and excitatory input currents. This is something that is simulated by our model and has been measured in the red. And it has been also measured several times, also in mice, and typically the ratio is to the advantage of the inhibitory postsynaptic currents, so the amplitudes are much higher of the inhibitory currents. And this is what also our model captures. The relationship of the firing rate and the alpha power is captured by the model. The relationship between EG, rhythm power, in this case alpha power, and the Bolt signal. This is a simulation, and this inverse relationship is also has been published many, many times. Then this is interesting, scale freeness, scale invariance, has been published for non-invasive imaging data and humans. And there's a sign of complexity is also generated by our model. And if you're interested, you can look in the paper. We explain how it emerges. So it's not present in a single population. It's a result of the network interaction. So if we switch off the network, then the scale-free behavior disappears in the signal. And then the switching of the functional connectivity. Importantly, all these features were not introduced artificially in the model. The model was tuned or optimized. So it has three parameters. Based on the time courses of the Bolt signal, the region-wise time courses. So this was used for optimization.
But Petra, so we can have, there are many questions, right? If you look at the at the bench, set of benchmarks like this. And so first, for instance, when can we say that we satisfy a benchmark? Like if you look at your alpha distribution, mm-hmm. Like the first one in monkey, mm-hmm. Like, if I squint a bit, I could say, well, it looks sort of the same. But if I would quantify that similarity across these histograms, it would not be like a big correlation.
Right. So what we actually did is we looked whether principles are maintained in the simulated data. And what you see here is that at the peak, of you refer to this picture, right?
Yeah.
At the peak of the alpha cycle, we have a trough of the firing rate, and this is also the case here. And we relate this actually very nicely to the emergence of this relationship. So this is tightly related to the subsequent relationships that are seen here, the firing rate and the power, and also the inverse relationship between alpha power then and the Bolt signal. So without this relationship, these would not follow. And we found that this describes actually a theory of our observations, which is pretty nice and which we want to come up with. Nevertheless, my perspective is that how do we generate knowledge? This is a question, right? And I think it is through falsification at the end. So now we have constructed this model, and this is nice. But what is the next step? We would not claim this is now the end of the road, and we have the perfect model. But we try to falsify it, actually, and find some mistakes. And maybe you're right, and this is not perfect, and it could be better. And probably, and most likely, many other features that are not shown here are not captured by the model. But if we have the claim that we really want to understand the brain and not just use the model for a certain purpose, it could be perfect, right? But if we want to really understand the processes, then it is likely that several of the assumptions in the model are not good enough, are imprecise, and in the future, hopefully, they can be improved.
Alpha now, you get something that is oscillating in the alpha range, mm-hmm. Because you have the coupling between excitatory and inhibitory populations, and their specific time constants will give you this kind of oscillatory dynamics, right? But if we look at, let's say, behavior, mm-hmm. then we see a lot of stuff happens in the gamma range, right?
Yes.
And that's an, of course, an obvious question. How would you now, in this framework, mm-hmm. maintain your alpha mm-hmm. dynamics and also get gamma?
I come to this, actually.
Ah, great, okay. Yeah.
So I hope I can satisfy you.
Okay, good. I'll hold my horses.
So, but just to summarize again, what we really want to do is to bring together the different snippets of observations that are distributed around the globe and try to connect them in order to understand, to generate new knowledge or new theories. And this should be one example of a basically new built theory, which is materialized in form of the model that I showed you. This is the model again, and I now just want to add a little detail that I haven't mentioned to not distract you. Some of you might be really wondering, how is it possible to simulate a complex adaptive system like the brain for 20 minutes and make predictions of precise time courses, sequence of events for 20 minutes? In principle, this is not possible because there's stochasticity in the brain, and you cannot predict for 20 minutes how my brain would look like. So it can change every second without being predictable. What we did is we added some additional information, which was the EEG source activity, and we injected, this is shown here, the simultaneously with fMRI measured EEG source activity in our population modes. Why did we do this? Population nodes. Because we were interested in seeing how this brain network model reacts to realistic inputs. So typically, you might be aware of, you drive such models with noise, then you generate an average functional connectivity and are happy if there are some good matches with the empirical average functional connectivity or some statistical relationships. But what has not been done is in the past to really look at whether the dynamics that can be generated by such a model make sense. And in order to see this, we have to not inject noise, because this is not what goes in a population, but we have to approximate the local activity. The global activity comes from the distant nodes, but the local activity also introduces in a population. And this is what you can measure with local field potentials when you stick an electrode in a brain, but this is not possible in Jessica. So we use the EEG source activity as an approximation of the local excitatory activity, and we injected it in the population nodes instead of noise. So we replaced the noise by this approximation of the local excitatory activity, and we tested the system, whether the system, the large-scale brain network model, is capable of simulating something realistic like the resting state fMRI activity. And this is possible. So so far, the model seems to make sense. It can generate resting state fMRI activity. And as you can see here, the inverse relation between the Bolt signal and the alpha activity. We put basically the virtual brain here to the test, whether it can simulate meaningful, biologically plausible activity. Now I show you data that are not yet published, but I find them exciting. And I show them because typically in the past I always have been asked when I was presenting the virtual brain, the question came always, okay, fine, you are simulating some activity, features, dynamics, and so forth, but can it really generate function? And this is, of course, also a question that I was asking myself. And so what has been published already by others is the link between functional connectivity and intelligence. So we reanalyzed the human connect home project data, for which this relationship has been published. So there in Actually, we analyzed 742 of the 1,000 individuals there because for some data, imaging data was missing. And for this cohort, it has been shown that the intelligence score, the fluid intelligence, or the G factor, the general intelligence, are related and highly significantly correlated to average functional connectivity. And we recomputed this. So here you see functional connectivity. Here you see the intelligence scores. And we could reproduce this relationship in the data, which has been published before. Interestingly, if you look at the reaction time is also correlated with intelligence in this data set. So the higher the intelligence, the longer it took the individuals to respond to the intelligence tasks. And if you look now, so we grouped now the reaction time for 12, generated 12 reaction time groups and looked how this is related to functional connectivity. And there's also a strong link between the functional connectivity of the individuals and the reaction time.
So we're plotting here the mean correlation in functional connectivity during the resting state.
Yes.
Okay.
Right.
So but then it's very compressed, right, to your correlation with the score. Mm-hmm. The range you have in the functional connectivity measure is 0.01.
Right. Yeah. But it's significant, and so we are not the first to report this. This is a Nature Neuroscience paper actually that reported it first. And we just wanted to look whether we also see it in the data, and we basically can reproduce.
But they reported the same range, or the range you have is more compressed, or it's the same range?
It's the same range, okay. So now, if this is the case, the for us challenging question is to see how this feature function connectivity with the virtual brain can be linked to real brain function. And in order to address this, we first have to really reproduce these. You actually hit the point, Paul. So these are very subtle differences indeed. So we have to be capable with the model to capture these subtle differences. And with our traditional model, this was not possible. So what we did is we advanced the model and now also included feedforward long-range inhibition, which is present in the brain. So it exists, nobody would question this. But what was so far used in brain network modeling was only long-range excitation. So this is a traditional way of connecting the populations on excitatory inhibitory populations. This is one neural mass model. And this then sends information to the distant excitatory populations, as you can see here, but nothing to the distant inhibitory populations. No feed-forward inhibition, which has been shown many, many times to exist in the brain. So what we now did is we introduced this feed-forward inhibition. So we have now long-range excitation plus feed-forward inhibition. And we have to tune, to optimize this ratio between feed-forward inhibition and long-range excitation.
So and what does long range mean here? What is long range?
So long range means between distant populations.
Yeah, but how distant?
All. So
it's all to all.
All to all. All that are present in the structural connectivity matrix. So long range excitation is the excitation between all connected populations in the brain. And this is what is already in TBB. But the advance is to not just have long range excitation.
No, I got that.
But yeah, what is
no? Look, if you look at this Henry Kennedy graph of the cortex in macaque,
yeah,
right, he's sort of emphasizing that long range is still bounded with this exponential decay rule.
Yes.
Right. So it's not long range; it's really bounded, and we talk millimeters, right? So. Are you also imposing that constraint, or you allow long range to really go to all the nodes?
Actually, we use just the structural connectivity matrix that we always use before, nothing else. The distance is in there. Mm-hmm. So I'm not talking about local connectivity, but about the structural connector that is at the heart of DBB. Mm-hmm. And for this, So usually it was used as long-range excitation. The connections were long-range excitatories. So long-range, this means just the connections in the structural connector. What we added now is in the same structural connector with the same distances, feed-forward inhibition.
Sure, I got that, yeah.
Okay, then maybe we can discuss it.
No, it's just about anatomical, just anatomical details.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just questioning what the anatomy would really support in terms of physical distance in the brain. But that's a discussion we can have later.
Okay, but the physical distance on the brain, I mean, this is depends on the parcellation, right, of our brain.
No, like Henry Kennedy used tracer injections to really establish physically what connections you can find and what distance. And then with Markov, there's a nice study where they show this drops off exponentially with distance, and the drop off is measured in millimeters. So long range is bounded within that range of a few millimeters at best. Okay. And it's exponentially decaying. So that, of course, raises an interesting question, because that's like a kernel you could impose on your functional connectivity to say, well, whatever my assumption about functional connectivity, it must still be implemented using those wiring constraints, right? So that's a little bit the discussion I was after.
Oh, okay, but so that long-range structural connectivity and also functional connectivity exists is not debated, right? Or is that what
it
your
is.
Question
is? It is,
okay,
that's
this
the point.
Is, this is exactly
yes.
the point. So the interhemispheric inhibition that has been shown several times, this is not probably existent?
No, that's not being debated, but it's a local connectivity in the cortical graph.
Mm-hmm.
And that just follows an exponential decay rule that's bounded at the scale of a few millimeters at max.
But the local connectivity, we are not simulating.
No, right? Beyond that, there's nothing. That's the claim Henry Kennedy and Dave Van Essen have made.
So I would, to be honest, doubt that.
No, we can. Yeah. Okay. Henry is one of the leading anatomists, right, that we have around. And these are the best measurements we have today. Of course, it can be.
It could be.
Yeah.
So it could be easily incorporated. It's actually interesting, but it could incorporate it and see whether then the simulations are more plausible.
Exactly. Yeah. That was my whole question, whether you included these constraints or not.
To be honest, I find the constraints, as I understood them now, implausible, but I will read it and see whether I missed a part.
Sure, no. This is, that's what the science is about.
Yeah.
Can I ask, the empirical functional connectivity refers to real measured?
Empirical means really measured.
What I wonder is, because we know from test fitness studies that empirical functional connectivity has a test fitness 0.5, 0.4, so it means that it's a lot of driven by noise.
This is a human connectome project data, which has very high quality and long acquisition times for functional connectivity.
But even there, the test fitness doesn't go above 0.6, 0.7, meaning like that at most, the stability of the signal itself, from a technical perspective, explains 40% of variance.
Why?
How can we as a simulation fit the data so well that it explains 90%?
So why shouldn't they? Why do you doubt?
Because
this?
If it's 60% is noise, so then a simulation which explains noise is a very...
Maybe it does. So it's possible, right?
But it's a technical noise.
Maybe even technical. So what we are simulating here is basically just the consequence of the fitting procedure to the data that we have, right? So the data, the signal in the data plays into the result of the simulation. I think the important point here is that with the feed-forward inhibition, we are coming much closer to the features of the empirically measured functional connectivity, be it noise or whatsoever. I don't know, but we can capture the differences that we measure between the individuals and between the.
And then the feed-forward inhibition is like uniform for the whole matrix, for all nodes, or
so
is there some regional specificity to it?
It's heterogeneous. It's region specific, but it's reproducible. So one question would be then: is it generalizable? Right. So this is a very important question. And for this, we have run 1,000 simulations with different initial conditions. So the initial conditions matter, of course, for the ratio between excitation and inhibition are the randomly changed that for the re-simulations. And we also did another 1,000 simulations where we changed the order of the tuning algorithm, because the tuning algorithm is sequential, so it goes from region to region, and we changed the sequence of the tuning. So the important point is that when we did the re-simulations, actually the parameter values that we inferred could differ, so there's an identifiability issue, but I want to convince you that we do not care about this. Because the input correlations, and I go now to the next slide, this explains it. So here you see the functional connectivity, and from our model inferred input currents. By the way, I hope I notice already now the talk will be longer than expected because we have a lot of discussion. I hope this is fine. Is there something afterwards?
No.
Okay. So we can compute now the input currents in relation to the functional connectivity. And what we noticed was that this higher functional connectivity, the input currents decrease. This means higher intelligence group, higher functional connectivity between region pairs, and decreased input currents. And this relationship, this also dynamics of the input currents, was highly reproducible in the individuals if we re-simulated the data with different initial conditions and with different sequences of parameter optimization.
But
so
not fully. Yeah. This is only model, or this is also empirical?
So this is the model.
This
just
is only model.
Only model.
Okay.
Yeah. And this is the input current. So this is again the reduced from one model. This is the basis of the input current that we are plotting here. So what we also noted, what I don't show here, is that while the relation between functional connectivity and input current is inverse, which actually is something that one wouldn't intuitively know immediately, so this is an output of the simulation. The degree of correlation of these input currents is positively correlated with functional connectivity. So if you have a high Borel functional connectivity between two regions, then the input currents that drive these two regions are also highly correlated. So again, an inverse correlation between the strength of input currents and functional connectivity, and a positive correlation between the input current correlation and the functional connectivity.
But is this a surprise? Because you know you have balancing of excitation and inhibition in your model. So the more I'm going to link nodes together, right, the more this kind of automatic gain control system will be engaged. So that would mean that I can drive it with a lower input current. No.
Okay, if you're not surprised, that's also fine.
No, I'm just wondering.
It's
a question.
It is a case, and it makes sense. And we found it out. I did not actually even think about it before, but this came out. And it's interesting now, because now we related to function in the brain. And this is what where I come now. So this was all the pre-work. But what we now really want to do is to relate all these features to brain function. And for this, we implement in the brain network model functional circuits that simulate working memory and decision making. And this is such a functional circuit. It was published by Murray and Wang in 2017, and so what we have are two excitatory populations that are mutually inhibiting via an inhibitory population. And so to simulate working memory, I will detail this a little bit more in a later slide, we basically the populations go in an attractor state, and to simulate decision making, there's winner take it all competition between these two excitatory populations that are mutually inhibiting. I did explain it in a moment in more detail. This is a working memory scenario. Ah, by the way, the two nodes were implemented in prefrontal cortex and in intraparietal cortex. So now, if we stimulate one of the two competing excitatory populations of such a circuit with a stimulus, it can reach, if it is strong enough, an attractor state that is persistent. If we then, after here 2 seconds, inject another
current in the distractor population, the other excitator population, then we have different scenarios. Either the already formed memory trace attractor state is stable enough and is maintained, or it is disturbed and stops. Or this is a third scenario, the initial stimulus was not strong enough to generate an attractor state and a memory trace. And now we can look how this input current strength that is related to functional connectivity and the correlation of the input currents are related to these scenarios. So we have the low intelligence group here. This is just the reference model, the high intelligence group. And the difference between them is the input current strength in the population. So now blue indicates the scenario where we have disruption of the memory trace, this scenario. Red indicates the scenario where the memory trace is maintained. And white indicates a scenario where no memory trace has been generated at all. So now we see for the low intelligence group that only a small input current is sufficient in order to go in this blue region and disrupt the attractor state of the working memory trace. So this would be the scenario. So small and low intelligence with high input currents, a small stimulus is sufficient to disrupt a memory trace. And high intelligence with low input current, we see that we need a higher input current to disrupt a memory trace. On the other hand, we see that in the high intelligence group with a low input current, we need from the beginning a higher stimulus in order to actually elicit a working a memory trace, an attractor state. This means that if you have only a small stimulus, which would be sufficient to elicit a memory state in the low intelligence group, it would be regarded as noise in the high intelligence group. And this can be a benefit because then minor stimuli are ignored and the resources are maintained or stay free for more salient and maybe more important stimuli. Now I come to the decision-making scenario. So the decision-making is inspired by this visual experiment with ambiguous motion of the dots. And this is mimicked by stimulating the two excitatory populations, and one of the two gets a slightly stronger stimulus input. And this is called the contrast. So the difference of the input between A and B. So now again, you see the activity. In this case, we plot the firing rates of the two competing populations, A and B, in the two models, so low intelligence and the high intelligence model. And we see that again, the two different model scenarios matter for the functioning of our functional circuits. So in the low intelligence group, we see that the activity, this is a stimulation time, ramps up immediately of the blue population, and the decision is taken. So decision is taken when the activity reaches a certain threshold, and attractor, basin, at this time, no, the evidence accumulation does not continue and the decision is taken. So here you see we have the stimulation and the ramping up of the blue population is much slower. This is a high intelligence group. So there's much more time for evidence accumulation and for averaging out the noise. Now we can look how the input strengths and the input correlation change these behaviors. And if we look at the input strengths, we see this is an integration time that the lower the input strengths, the blue plot, the higher is the integration time. So lower input current, higher intelligence, higher integration time. This is also in accordance with what has been found by the people from the Human Connectome Project, longer response times, higher intelligence, better decisions. This is also reproduced by the model. Now, if we look at the input correlation, this is a contrast, this is the input correlation, and the color indicates the percent of correct decisions. So we have good performance in the white area and bad performance in the dark area. So it seems with higher input correlation, it's getting whiter. So if we look at a intermediate, medium contrast, then by increasing the input correlation, we can actually move the performance from a red, poor performance area to a white, high performance area. So this is how the model tells us how the background correlations and the input strengths in a network modulate the performance, the functional performance. And at the end, it doesn't matter actually if there was any overfitting or not. So what we could think of is we now have a heterogeneous feed forward inhibition long range excitation. So what we have replaced is the zero feed forward inhibition. So before that, we had the assumption every TVB modeler, everybody who did brain network modeling assumed that long range inhibition is zero. And now this assumption is replaced by heterogeneous distribution of long range inhibition. And if we do this, we can show that indeed we can reproduce the performance behavior that is observed in high intelligence and low intelligence groups and the relation to the functional connectivity in the brain.
But you also had the reaction time effect, right? So you're going to show us how you account for that? Like earlier you showed that the functional connectivity measure also correlated to the reaction time, and people who are good at the Raven will have short reaction time, right? So, but here it looks like the networks make the decision roughly at the same point in time, or do I not read that correctly?
No, I think, so here we see the relationship of the reaction time and the input current, and it's clear that with lower input current, the reaction time is getting longer. But I come also back to, there will be another nice visualization, but there's a clear relationship. So basically we are reproducing this empirical relationship that I have shown before. And now I'll show you the phase space and to also illustrate the purpose of looking at the phase space in order to understand the behavior of a complex system. So here we have the phase space spent by the state variable of the of one population A, the one excitator population, and the other competing excitator population B. We have four scenarios, four different input correlations, background input correlations or functional connectivities, 0, 0, 5, 0, 9, 1, 0. The contrast that we choose here was 0.2, so the A population gets slightly stronger input than the B population. So what we see here, the thin gray lines are 1,000 simulations. And you see the filled circles, so the filled black circles are the two basins of attraction, the two stable attractor states. And the orange lines are the averages of the 1,000 simulations. And you see that so there were scenarios when the decision went in one direction or in the other direction, to one of the two attractor states. The red line is a separatrix that separates the two basins of attractions. What should be purple but looks more gray here, these lines are the flow fields of the phase space. And they indicate the velocity with which the system, the state variable, moves into an attractor state. So what we now observe is, and the green and the blue are the null clients of the two state variables. So what we see now is that depending on the connectivity, the system, the state variables stay closer or less close to the separatrix. So here, with a very low functional connectivity, we see that the state variables quickly move apart from the red separatrix. Here, for higher functional connectivity, they stay close to the separatrix for longer, here even longer, and here with 100% correlation, actually the decision goes only to the right side, to the right attractor state. So what does it mean? It means that the correlation decides how balanced the two state variables are. The more correlations a system, the more balanced is the activity in A and B population, and the closer it stays to the separatrix. If it is close to the separatrix, then the flow field is lower. So as soon as it goes to a certain point apart from the separatrix, the velocity to one of the two attractors is getting higher, and then for the subsequent events or inputs, it is difficult to pull the state back to the separatrix. So if it once has moved apart from the separatrix, then it very likely comes to decision soon. So being for longer time balanced means the system has more time to average the noise, which is in the stimulus, and the noise will average out, and it is more time to accumulate the real evidence, and therefore the decision at the end becomes better. So this is the end of this story, and now I completely switch to clinical application. So this was all the healthy brain, but of course it was related to cognitive function, and the scenario I showed you with working memory and decision making and coming to wrong decisions and then sticking with these wrong decisions, this could be also a mechanism, for example, related to to schizophrenia. So this is a common, a typical scenario that in schizophrenia you come to a wrong decision. You have a perception and have a wrong interpretation of this perception. So it might be interesting for the scenario of schizophrenia. But I show you what has been published now already with the virtual brain software in terms of clinical applications to give you a little bit the big picture. Also, this is a study from collaborators who used to be at Irvine University in California, but now moved to Dallas in Texas. This is a graphical user interface of the software. The software is a graphical user interface and a script interface. Here you see a stroke brain with a big lesion. And they have virtualized like about 16 or 20 of those patient brains with chronic stroke. And they have selected a handful, like three parameters, and fitted the simulated functional connectivity to the empirical functional connectivity of these individuals, inferred these three parameters. And then the patients underwent rehabilitation. Half a year of rehabilitation, they all had a motor deficit. And after this rehabilitation phase, and then again 1 year later, the motor performance has been measured with a clinical score, Fugelmeier score. And this has been then related to the parameters that have been determined 6 months or 1 year before with TVB. And there was a very nice and significant correlation with some of the parameters. One was K12, which is a coupling, the local coupling of the excitatory to inhibitory population. So this indicates, even though it's not sufficient for sure, that the parameters which have some biological meaning might be close to the real neuronal processes, and they might be good predictors for different disease scenarios, for disease trajectories. This has to be still proven, but this is the first step towards this. So how can that be proven? Of course, larger cohorts, new data sets, and so forth. And we are also working on a nice data set now from Hamburg, where they have a longitudinal monitoring with many modalities, simultaneous EEG, fMRI, also task data, where, and even TMS simulation, where one could, in principle, even validate based on those data whether this inferred difference in the coupling really can be actually proven through transcranial magnetic stimulation. Through the response to this. So this is one application, stroke. Other application you might be aware of, it's done in Marseille by Victor Gierza's group, is epilepsy. So for epilepsy, one virtualizes the brains of the epileptic patients. Here's one, I think this was a 4-year female from Marseille who had intracranial electrodes. 30% of these patients do not react to drugs, so the only possibility to help them is neurosurgery and to plan the neurosurgery. one has to find the origin of the seizure, the epileptogenic zone, and also the likely way or pathways of distribution in the brain. And for this, here you see a simulation now of this brain. Also, the sites of the intracranial electrodes are simulated here. It is here simulated seizure that spreads over the brain to the other hemisphere and then in the contralateral temporal lobe terminates. So here now, this is again one example patient. The study has been done on a group of patients. I think it was like 16 again. So in this example patient, you see how the clinical expert team identified the potential epileptogenic zone for the neurosurgeon. And this is a red area. And then the computer model also made a prediction of the epileptogenic zone. This is a green area and the yellow area. So as an overlap between the clinical expert team and the computer simulation. This has been done by all the patients shown here, each represented by a dot. Then they underwent surgery following the advice of the clinical expert team, totally ignoring. Neurosurgeons didn't know about the virtual brain simulation. And then afterwards, the outcome is measured with the Engel score. The Engel score, again, a clinical score, indicates either there's no improvement at all, these four guys had no improvement, or there's some decrease of the frequency of seizures, Engel score 2, or the patients are seizure-free after surgery. Here, this axis shows the divergence between the clinical prediction, the clinical expert team, the human prediction, and the computer model prediction. And it has been shown in this publication, on this set of publications, that significantly the higher the divergence, the disagreement between the model prediction and the clinical expert team, the worse was the outcome for the patient. And this is indicated that first, with the model, one can predict the outcome for the patient after surgery, but second, maybe the model knows better. This is not clear from this data. And so as a consequence of these publications and this evidence, now a clinical trial has been started in France that started just a few weeks ago with the first patients. Altogether over 4 years, there will be 400 patients included, will be blinded. So there will be one half of the patients, 200 patients, treated exactly as was done in the past. And the other half of the people will be treated with additional knowledge gained with TVB. So it's not merely based on TVB predictions, but the clinical expert team's insights will be added with the virtual brain prediction. So after 4 years, we will know whether the outcome of the group that takes into account the virtual brain prediction will be better or not. This is another application by scientists at the Ghent University. They virtualized the brains of patients with brain tumors. And they also selected a handful of three parameters that's a fitting with the functional connectivity. And they found that the coupling, the feedback inhibition between the inhibitor and excitator population was predictive for brain tumor or not brain tumor. This is a publication using neurodegenerative data. Again, each of the dots represents one brain. This is a memory and aging, Sydney memory and aging study with 16 Alzheimer's disease patients, 32 mild cognitive impairment patients, and I think 74 healthy controls. These are the biophysical model parameters, somehow summarized. These are the cognitive scores. So it seemed that the biophysical model parameters inferred were predictive for the cognitive scores. But what is actually the more nice outcome is that now the change of cognitive function can be related to the change of the different model parameters. So you see, for example, a decrease of the global coupling, an increase of the inhibition to local inhibition to excitation coupling and so forth. And thus you get a mechanistic insight of what is changing, which neuronal processes in the brain are changing with a change of certain cognitive features. So now, of course, we know that we need a lot of validation in order to really make any use of all this data that I have shown you. Probably the most advanced are the epilepsy data, because there we have a clinical trial now. We need validation with large data cohorts, with also not just historic data, but also progrediently acquired data. What we also know is that these diseases, like neurodegenerative disease, they have an origin on the molecular or genetic level, also schizophrenia, for example. So the big challenge is now to link this large scale, this very coarse scale of the virtual brain, to the world of the genes and the molecules. So this is where the origin of the diseases sits. And I give you an example how we did this. In a just recently published study. So this was also about neurodegenerative disease. We used data of patients from the ADNI database, Alzheimer's Disease Neuroimaging database. And there we also get PET data that measure beta amyloid and tau protein. And these are proteins that are accumulating in the brains of patients with dementia and especially Alzheimer's disease. Animal research and also cellular research has shown that the amyloid beta, so in the vicinity of the amyloid beta, the activity of inhibitory interneurons is decreased. So these are inhibitory postsynaptic potentials in the vicinity of amyloid beta, and this is a firing rate of the neurons, which is also lower. So it seems there's some accumulated evidence now that amyloid beta protein is something that accumulates in patients with Alzheimer's disease, and it has an impact on the function of inhibitory interneurons. So now, how can we link this change of a signal pathway or metabolics in this case to our population-based model? So we know that there's an accumulation of these amyloid beta oligomers, there are the amyloid beta plaques. This can be measured with PET. This is now a distribution of amyloid beta in the brain as measured with PET, averaged across the regions of the parcellation chosen here in this study. So this color code indicates the burden with amyloid beta. We know from the literature that in the vicinity of amyloid beta, the inhibitory interneurons activity decreases, which leads to disinhibition and hyperexcitation. And this is something that we can implement in a model if we choose a suitable population model. So of course, if we have only a single oscillator, that wouldn't work. But if we use a detailed enough model, and this could be, for example, the Janssen-Ritt model, that mimics or that summarizes the activity and also the relation between the inhibitory interneurons and the pyramidal cells, this feature can be implemented in our model. So this is the Janssen-Ritt model that basically consists of the activity of inhibitory interneurons, pyramidal cells, and excitatory interneurons. And we now modulate the coupling between the inhibitory interneurons and the pyramidal cells as a function of the beta amyloid burden that we take from our PET data. So with this now, we integrate in the virtual brain another modality, PET. And we did this. I shorten this here a little bit. This is the outcome already. So for the three groups that we get from the ADNI database, healthy control, mild cognitive impairment, and Alzheimer's disease. Here you see the frequency that we find in our, on average across all regions in our simulated signal. Just by incorporating, so the only difference between the models is the incorporation of the PET inferred beta burden that modulates via sigmoidal function the degree of coupling between the inhibitory interneurons and the pyramidal cells. And this change leads to an increase of the low frequencies in our simulations, which we can also observe in Alzheimer's disease patients. So it seems that this single modification of our model can mimic a feature that we see also on the large scale and empirical data. So now I come to the question that you posed, Paul, previously, how we can take care of these different frequency patterns in the brain. So we did look at this in the context of these dementia patients and the context of the Hansen-Witt model. And this nicely illustrates this, how changes of parameters in the model change the repertoire, the dynamic repertoire of the model. So what we see here is a bifurcation analysis, and in the next slide I switch back to the signals that are a consequence of, that basically come from the same system, but just represent another view of the system. So this is a bifurcation diagram that shows the pyramidal cell activity as a function of one of the parameters of the model, which is a time constant of the coupling of the inhibitory population to the pyramidal cells. And this is the feature that we modulate in our simulations in dependence of the beta amyloid burden. So here you see we have just modified these values, 14 milliseconds, 22, and I can't read this, 50 or so. Yeah, and just the modification of this parameter changes the repertoire. We see here a limit, so-called limit cycle. So next slide, I show you how the signal for this looks like. Here you see the system has two limit cycles. This means just that it switches between two different oscillations. And here it has only a single type of oscillation. And here then another limit cycle occurs. If we look at the signals generated by these systems, then we see for this value, we get alpha oscillations. for this value, we get a mixture. We have the two limit cycles between theta and alpha oscillations as the switching. And for this value, we get just theta activity. So it's these parameters that can actually modulate the frequency of your system. So now, how can we incorporate this in our virtual brain models? Either we do it through dynamic parameters. So if there is a reason to believe that some of the parameters change independent of something, then there's a possibility to make them dynamic. And just having such a dynamic, there could be even a plasticity algorithm that changes this parameter, would introduce different frequencies in the system. We haven't done it yet, and it sounds complicated, but it would be a possibility. Right. So here you see a very simple simulation of a drug effect in the context of dementia. For dementia, you might know that for Alzheimer's disease there is no real drug, but one uses NMDA antagonists to at least relieve the symptoms for a while of dementia. NMDA antagonist memantine can be also simulated in the model that I just showed you by now blocking the modulation of the excitatory interneurons to the pyramidal cells. So it's just the other side of the Hansen-Witt model that I showed you before. And when doing so, we see that just by adding this change in the model, the slowing that you see here, so we have again blue healthy control, mild cognitive impairment, and green Alzheimer in red. Here we have now on the y-axis the frequencies, and we see that compared to mild cognitive impairment and to healthy control, the frequencies are much lower in the Alzheimer's disease group. If we just change this parameter, the NMDA coupling, then immediately, otherwise the models stay the same with the same beta burden of the PET data and so forth, we can get a normalization of this, possibly mimicking the drug effect. We don't know. But this is just an example of how, in principle, one can do a virtual drug test on the computer. So what is the goal? Why are we doing all this? What would we hope? The hope is that through the modeling, we come closer to the real neuronal processes and interactions that we cannot measure. And also, we can assess the potential, the reserves, the capacity of the system if we have constructed it once on the computer. So we believe, and this is what we are testing now and also preparing, and this is an old plot because I didn't have a new one, but we have better ones now already, actually. How can we increase the characteristics, the statistical properties of already existing biomarkers for the classification of patient groups with Alzheimer's disease, with mild cognitive impairment? This is the first step. For this, one uses a receiver operating curve that displays sensitivity versus specificity, and a good biomarker is here, sits here in this corner. So it is highly specific and highly sensitive. And that depends always on the purpose for what you need the biomarker, how much in that corner it has to sit. But what we show now is by using all the empirical data that we have for classification between mild cognitive impairment and Alzheimer and healthy controls versus using the features inferred with the virtual brain, which hopefully sit closer to the real biological mechanisms, can we improve the prediction and the area under the curve. And indeed, we could show already a slight improvement. We have a higher improvement now with a better classification method, which I have no figure for yet. And the guy starts in January with us who did the analysis. He's now in Canada still. But this is the hope, and this is why I show it. It's not yet published. We want to find biomarkers based on the neuronal processes that we infer with the virtual brain in order to make a diagnosis, but in the future also to, at a very early stage, already recognize, hopefully, the trajectory of different dementia. So it's very difficult, actually, impossible before the symptoms come, but also when the symptoms are there, to differentiate between different types of dementia. There are some types of dementia that can be treated, other types of dementia, like Alzheimer's disease, where no treatment at the moment exists, but several experimental trials also are running, and it would be very helpful to do a proper classification, ideally before the symptoms start. Why is that? Because then if, for example, beta amyloid would be one mechanism that hurts the neurons, the inhibitory interneurons, there were many pharmacological trials, actually they all were stopped prematurely, phase two trials, just a couple of them few weeks ago, and some of the pharma concerns that totally left the field of research because it was too expensive and nothing came out. So if you want to target the beta amyloid, then in the moment when the patient has already the symptoms, it might be too late, and therefore all the pharmacological and drug interventions fail. But if you do that before the symptoms come, before the neurons are damaged, then it might be still possible. This has to be proven, but identifying those people at risk would be necessary in order then to do these trials with them. And this is a hope, one of the hopes we have with the Virtual Brain Cloud. This is actually the consortium, 17 partners, one of which is Paul here, and also Pietro with Iodine. Actually, I never understand who is the boss of Iodine, and so you are all, yeah. So Iodine and eBay are partners there, and we are very happy about this, because the goal is to really at the end have applications, decision-making machineries that can be used by clinicians, but also by scientists and by students and by patients. I just want to give you a hint that we make some fun stuff with our simulations. We do, we program little applications. This is the latest thing we did. Does it start? Yes, this is an atlas that we programmed for a human brain project exhibition. It's interactive. It works on these touch screens. And the demand was to have four languages. It's in English, Arabian, Hebrew, German, and we presently add other languages, Russian, for example. This actually was not the easiest because we do not understand it, and the entire geometry of the language is different to make that part of this. But what you can do is either go through the different function labels or choose functional networks, let them display there, get some explanation of the functional role here, or just touch them or rotate, whatsoever, choose what you want and learn about it. And this is now part of a traveling exhibition of the Human Brain Project that started in Israel a month ago. also. And this is a nice side effect that since we have all the data in the model already, we can reuse them and use them for whatever we need. And this is actually also one of the ideas behind the virtual brain and the human brain project and virtual brain cloud, to bring the data together to make them consistent. And only if they are really available in a very clean and nice way, processed with the same methods, reproducible in the same reference framework, then we can use them together and learn from them. And well, this is just the art project where people can control with this app that works with these neural headsets. So up to 20 people can interact together with the app and the neural headsets and control these large dream scenarios. So they control the music and also the visual library that has been created by an artist. And depending on their synchronization or desynchronization, this can generate good dreams or bad dreams or whatever. And that's the end. Thank you.